At the end of this online module, you should be able to differentiate between built-in and user-defined functions in MATLAB, construct an appropriate function definition line, match the variable names used in the function definition line to those used in the function code, execute a user-defined function, and create a test case to evaluate a user-defined function. In order to understand user-defined functions, we will start by differentiating between scripts and functions. First, both scripts and functions are .m files that execute MATLAB programming statements. A script stores and executes commands exactly as if they were typed into the command window. This means if you want to change anything before you run the script again, you must open it, change what needs to be changed, resave, and then rerun the script. Like a script, a function also allows you to reuse code without retyping all of the commands into the command window or into the .m file. However, unlike a script, a function can accept input arguments that are assigned when calling the function. These input arguments are values used within the function. A function can also return output arguments that are variables with values that are available to use from the command window once the function is executed. Finally, one other major difference between scripts and functions is that because scripts run commands exactly as if they were typed in the command window, then all variables assigned while running the script are available in the workspace for use after a script is run. Whereas a function keeps its calculations and results inside a temporary function workspace that is deleted after the function runs. This function workspace is isolated from the normal primary workspace in MATLAB. A function communicates with the primary workspace using input and output arguments. Input arguments allow either typed values or variables from the MATLAB primary workspace to be sent into the function workspace. Output arguments allow variables from the function workspace to be sent to the MATLAB primary workspace. Okay, so now that we know more about the difference between scripts and functions, let's dig into the different types of functions in MATLAB. There are two major categories of functions. The first category is the MATLAB built-in functions. You have already been using these. They are the functions such as sine, sum, and pi. These are files that are embedded in the interface for MATLAB, and you can call them from the command window or within scripts or functions you create. Functions that are created by you, the MATLAB user, are called user-defined functions. These functions must be saved in your current directory in order to execute when called from the command window, scripts, or functions. Let's take a closer look at built-in functions to help us understand UDFs. For this demo, let's look at mean. Let's use a variable a that has three rows of 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 4, and 3, 4, 5, respectively. If we take the mean of a, we get that the answer is 2, 3, 4. As a reminder, the mean function takes the mean of each column. Here, A is our input argument, and ANS is our output argument. Luckily for us, mean is one of the built-in functions in MATLAB that allows us to see the underlying code by opening the .m file. Most built-in functions cannot be opened to see the code. To see the code, type open mean in the command window and press enter. Now you see an editor window with the code for the mean function. Let's explore this for a moment. The first line of the mean function is important to note. All functions start with the word function, as you see here. Then following this is the code that defines the function name, the input arguments, and the output arguments. The function name is mean. Whatever is in this spot is required to be the name of the function file. You can see here that this function is called mean.m. This code that is all comments is the help you see in the command window if you type help. Let's do that now. In the command window, type help mean. You can see that this text in the command window is exactly the text you see in the comments here in the editor window, except without the leading percent signs. If we scroll down, you can see the body of the code that runs the mean function. Now let's work on creating our own functions. MATLAB built-in functions are actually the same coding format as user-defined functions. As a reminder, a user-defined function, or UDF, is a MATLAB program created by the user, saved as a function file, which is still an .m file, and can be used like a built-in function when it's stored in the current folder. UDFs are tools to do work in MATLAB that can be repeated easily without having to code the process again. This is especially useful when changing input arguments is needed. So let's work on a problem within an engineering context that will help us make sense of user-defined functions. As we work on this, I recommend that you pull up a blank script or a function template and work through creating this UDF with me. Radioactive waste produces gamma rays that can potentially damage the DNA in cells of people who are nearby. Waste must have shielding to reduce exposure to gamma rays while transporting the radioactive waste to storage facilities. Your nuclear engineering team is designing metal shields and must create a MATLAB function that calculates and returns the exposure rate D in millirentgen per hour of gamma radiation behind a metal shield when given the thickness X in centimeters of the shield, the linear attenuation coefficient mu for the metal used in centimeters to the negative 1, and the exposure rate of unshielded material D naught in millirentgen per hour. Using this formula, D equals D naught times E to the negative mu times x. All right, before we begin coding, let's plan for our function. This function planning template is really useful to think about how to design your function. On the left are the input arguments that need to be defined in the command window. The box represents the function itself, and the right represents the output arguments that will get sent back to the primary workspace. Let's start with the function itself. What is its purpose? This function needs to calculate and return the exposure rate of gamma radiation behind a shield. Based on the description of the function, let's call it gamma underscore exposure. The function process is to input the variables on the right side of the equal sign and use them to calculate D, the exposure rate of the shielded material. For the input arguments to our function, we want to pass in shield thickness X, the linear attenuation coefficient mu, and the exposure rate of the unshielded material, D naught. Then once the function has executed, it should pass back the output argument, which is the exposure rate of the shielded material D. Now that we have planned our UDF, let's put it into action. So how do I start? In this course, we will always start with a user-defined function template. The first thing you need to do is to start documenting your UDF. The very first line of a function is the function definition line. Let's ignore that for now and move on to the header. This is the information that will be seen if help is used with the function, and is very similar to the script header. First is a description of what the function does. I'm going to use the same description I did in our planning. Don't forget to start each line with a percent sign to keep it a comment. The next is the function call. We will come back to that line in a moment. Next, define the input arguments you will use for the function. Again, from our plan, we have shield thickness, linear attenuation coefficient, and the exposure rate of the unshielded material. Notice I changed the variable names to be descriptive, rather than using x and mu and d naught. I also included the expected units for the input arguments. This is required in this course. Next is the output arguments. In this case, there is only one, the exposure rate of the shielded material. Again, use a descriptive variable name and include units. Finally, the template includes the assignment information and the academic integrity statements regarding working with collaborators. Make sure to fill these out each time. The very first line of a UDF is the function definition line. This line is used to tell MATLAB this is a function and allow for the exchange of input and output information. The general form of the function definition line is as follows. At a minimum, the function definition line must contain the keyword function, always the first word on the line, and the function name, which is the M file name without the .m. If there are input arguments, they must follow the function name in parentheses. If there are output arguments, they come before the function name, followed by an equal sign. If there are two or more output arguments, they must be in brackets. So let's return to our UDF and fill in our function definition line. Again, the first word on line 1 is function. Then the general format is bracketed output arguments, then an equal sign, followed by the function name, and finally the input arguments in parentheses. Our function name is gamma underscore exposure. This means that we also must save our function as the same name for it to run. Let's do that now. Be sure that where you save the function is the current folder, or it won't execute. For the problem we are solving, we have three input arguments that go here. I will put them in the order I listed them in the header. There is also one output argument, so we need to add those to our definition line. We need to make sure that we are using the exact same variable names we defined in the header, and we need to be sure that we are using all of the appropriate syntax. Since I only have one output argument, I do not actually need the square brackets. I would need them if I had a list of outputs. The input arguments are listed in parentheses, and a comma separates them. Now that I have completed the function definition line, I know what the function call will be. Again, the function call is what is typed in the command window, or in another script or function, to call this function. The function call is the same as the function definition line, but without the keyword function. So I just want to copy this and paste it here. Now we are ready to code our function. Since we are passing all of the information we need to perform the computations for this problem through the input argument list through the function definition line, we do not have variables to initialize here. So what might we initialize here? We would initialize variables that would not change for different scenarios. For instance, constants might be defined here, like gravity. But since we don't need gravity or any other constants for our problem, we will leave this part blank. So now I can move on to the calculations. I will start by making a block comment, then create the code to calculate the exposure rate behind the shield. Make sure to use the variable names defined in the input argument list. Since this is a new variable I am defining, I add a comment for the variable and the units. You know, I should probably think about inputs. Do all the inputs need to be scalar? Definitely not, as we could put in several different materials with different unshielded exposure rates and have different shield thicknesses. So we should anticipate that someone might use vector inputs. Therefore, I will add dot operators to my calculation so that the function can handle scalars and vectors. Once you have everything entered, resave the file. Now we need to think about testing our UDF. At the bottom, you will see a test case to check our UDF. Let's take a look at it. Cesium-137, a radioactive isotope of cesium, is a common waste product of uranium fission, which is common in nuclear energy plants. If the exposure rate at 2 feet from a cesium-137 source is 10 millirentgen per hour, what is the exposure rate at this point for the following lead shield thicknesses? 0.5 centimeters, 1 centimeter, 2 centimeters, and 5 centimeters. The shield would be erected between the source and the detector, and the linear attenuation coefficient is 1.23 centimeters to the negative 1 for the lead. This function would be one step in deciding how thick to make the lead shield so that the humans coming near the radiation exposure do not exceed the maximum exposure rate. In order to know if our MATLAB function is working properly, we can quickly calculate the shielded exposure rate by hand. So looking at our function planning schematic, our input arguments are the shield thickness, which are 0.5, 1, 2, and 5 centimeters, the linear attenuation coefficient, which is 1.23 centimeters to the negative 1, and the exposure rate, when not shielded, is 10 millirentgen per hour. In order to truncate this process a bit, I created an Excel spreadsheet to calculate each of the exposure rates when shielded. Here's a quick view of that Excel spreadsheet, including the formulas, so you can verify on your own if you would like. This resulted in the exposure rate with the shield in place being 5.41, 2.92, 0.85, and 0.02 millirentgen per hour, respectively. Now let's test our function to see that it also gives these values. I'm now ready to run my test cases in the MATLAB command window. I can call the function with just numerical inputs or assign each input a variable in the workspace, then call using those names. Let's just use the numbers. Here I type exposure equals gamma underscore exposure, and in parentheses, 10, 1.23, and 0.5. And I hit enter. My expected result is 5.41, but that is not my result. This is due to the order that I put the input argument values in the call. To remind us of the correct order, let's use the help function. Notice this is the function header info, and it tells me that the correct order is shield thickness, then linear attenuation coefficient, and then exposure rate of the unshielded material. The inputs must be in the expected order of the function definition line. So let's try again with the correct order. I type exposure equals gamma underscore exposure in parentheses 0.5, 1.23, 10. Hit enter, and now we get the expected answer. As with any MATLAB built-in function that has an output argument, I should assign the output of the function to a variable name. My variable name in the call does not have to match the variable name in the function definition line. Only values are being passed in and out of the function, not the variable names. Since I have three more examples, let's call each one a descriptive name. I'll call the 1 centimeter thickness expose underscore 1 centimeter. I'll change the thickness to be 1, hit enter, and I get the expected value. Now, let's do expose underscore 2 centimeters. Replace the value, hit enter, and get 0.85. Good. And finally, expose underscore 5 centimeters, replace that 5, and get 0.02. Excellent. So we got our expected results. Now, we did this test case as each calculation separately, but we could have used a vector, for example, the row vector 0.5, 1, 2, 5, for the shield thickness in one function call. You can try that now if you would like. Also consider playing with having vectors for the other variables before moving on. In summary, when you develop user-defined functions, make sure to always identify the function name and the input and output arguments before beginning to code. This planning will help you as your UDFs get more complicated. Always write a complete set of help lines by completing the header information. This is useful for debugging, remembering what your function does at a later time, and teaching a new user about your function. Write a function definition line using proper syntax. This first line of your UDF defines everything else in your function. Use all input arguments in the function computations within the code. Make sure these variable names match in both your function definition line and in your code. In the same vein, match the output arguments to variables created in the code. Call the function using proper syntax. The order of your inputs and outputs matter. And finally, run test cases to ensure your UDF is running as expected to anticipate any future errors.